The octopus bag is of big interest to a lot of people, and I've been hearing a lot about from you the past yesterday and today. I studied the octopus bags in a museum at in Anchorage. At that time, they had these statues of Tlingits, and they had the clothing on there. And I knew the curator, so I asked him if I could go in and study the octopus bags. And he said, sure, just go in there, but make sure you leave before 9, because that's when we open. So I was in there with my measuring tape and my notes and taking all these. I forgot all about the time. I looked up, and here's all these people looking at me from the outside. And I stood up real quick to leave, and this one lady screamed. She thought the statues came to life. But that's where I got my information from. And I used to see these bags all over and in Huna. And you see it in photographs, people wearing them. Usually they're hung on the wall, so I saw them a lot, and they were very flat. And that's the way they looked when you wore them. So it's really important to keep that in mind as we talk. The other thing I know about octopus is my brother and I used to have to hunt for octopus, and we had a really lazy day. My brother was tinkering around with different things. Some of you might know him, Kelly. And I was busy reading. My parents were real busy working. So finally my dad said, you're gonna have to get busy. I need an octopus. And so I said, okay. So we left. I had the bucket. And I don't know if any of you ever hunted octopus, but my brother had this long pole, and it's got a sharp point on it. And so we walked down. Those of you that know Huna, we went down by the ferry, on the other side of the ferry landing. It was a big boulder. And Kelly looked under there. He said, there's one under there, and it's a small one. He said, watch this. So he took the pole, and he poked in there real hard, and the octopus jumped out and right in front of him and stood right on its toes and stood right up to him, and my brother fell backwards, and it just went right into the ocean. I was laughing so hard. But when you think about the octopus, you think of them being with their tentacles out like this. But when that one stood up like this on its toes, and that's what these octopus bags look like. So I kind of can see how they came up with the design. There's a confusion about the octopus bags because they're found in the Algonquin country way over in the East Coast. And they're made exactly the same way. The designs are really different if you start looking at that. And it's really confusing when you look online and you find the bags are very floral, beautiful designs that are put on the bags. So the bags that are studied from over there are usually very beautiful and floral beadwork. And when you start looking at the Alaska, especially the Tlingit bags, our style is very different because we treat it as an actual octopus. So the bags need to have 8 tentacles. So that's where it really is hard to make the bags. So you can't 5 days before celebration, you can't run home and try to make one. So you better spend the winter working on it. I'll talk about the designs later, but we will look at the actual bag. And ladies, I want to point out to you that OCTOPUS bags are not for your Kleenex and for your change. The and tentacles are hollow all the way. There's no, that's the bottom of the bag. You can't put things in there. And when the OCTOPUS bag looks puffed up, then you shouldn't be putting stuff in there. And I don't know why they have it like that, but I know that people didn't put anything in there. And it's very, very flat looking. And if you lifted one of the problems we have today is the fabric, the materials that we have is very different. And it's really hard to find felt that is wool, unless you order it at a very expensive price. So only the front part of the bag is wool. The rest of it is cotton, as you will see. And I think I'm gonna have trouble holding this and try to show things too. If there is there a stand to put the mic on?
I think it's up there.
Yeah. This place is really not designed for people to do teaching and to make some tickets.
Okay.
12. You have a marker.
One through 12.
Yeah, we need to make 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. And then the same thing here, the one we're going to draw.
Okay.
Oh, hey, look at that. Okay. The wool that you have, that you find, you might have some good quality heavy wool that you can use. And for the show and tell, this is really light felt that I put on here. And I had to back it with an iron-on. Those of you that sew know that you can buy the iron-on. And if you use this, it won't look as good because the felt is too light. So one of the other things you can do is to go to the secondhand store and find a skirt that's made of wool. Take it apart and clean it and press it and then cut out your felt. And so if it's still too light, there's lots and lots of different kinds of iron-on materials that you can use. Only the front is wool. And I've seen some of these bags made here where they try to make the whole thing of wool. That isn't the way the original bags were made. Only the front was wool and the rest of it was cotton. But guess what? the cotton was really quality material, and it was heavy enough so that they didn't have to be backed. Now, if you buy cotton, maybe you can wash it and shrink it, but it still won't be heavy enough. So for the back, you can do an iron-on. There's a paper iron-on that is sticky on both sides, and that's what I used to do this. I ironed it on, and it makes it a little heavier. So then your bag will be put together like this. These bags are normally, if you get my pattern, which we will be giving out in a little bit, is they're normally 22 inches long. So don't make them bigger than that. They only need to be about 20. The ones that I studied were about 22 inches long, so that when you wear it like that, and also anything more than that, even for men, I think that if you're making it for a man to use, then the strap will be longer and different than for yourself. Make sure that it's long enough. But before I go any further, I made some patterns and instructions, and since I was doing this by hand, I only have 12. And what we're going to do is, somebody gave me tickets to use, and I think I packed it away in my suitcase to go home today. So I don't know where it is. So some of you will get a package, but it can be shared. So whoever wants to make a copy, and I have extra instructions here. So I asked Patty to help me because I'm blind in my right eye and almost blind in the other. So when you raise your hand, I won't be able to see you. So she's going to help me out, and we're going to also do the drawing. I made the packages of a pattern and instructions, and only made 12. So the subject is more popular than I thought. So we're trying to figure out how to choose you so we can have a drawing and have you. The patterns are not patented or anything like that. I just made it. So you can share with each other, so don't feel bad if you don't get it. I have extra instructions, and the patterns can be just copied. You can ask somebody, and you can just copy it and make your own, okay?
Do you want to ask if they know a Tlingit word?
Yeah.
That might be a way.
Okay. So if I'm going to honor my dad's people, Bak Den Ton, raise your hand. Way back there. How many? Two?
One, two, three.
Three. Okay.
Sisters.
Yeah. Okay. My mom's people from Haines. Anybody from Haines here?
One, two, three.
Six.
Three from Haines and three yeah. from your dad's.
Okay, let's go
four,
south.
Four.
Let's go south. That, how many is that? Seven?
Seven.
Yeah. Okay. Let's have Sitka. Nobody from Sitka?
Two.
Two?
Two.
So that's...
Two, that's nine.
The oldest banks that I have seen, or when I was growing up too, which is quite a long time ago, which reminds me of a t-shirt my husband has, it says, born in the USA a long time ago. These banks, apparently, they started making them after the fabric was made because the fabric was introduced because you don't see any other, either woven or any other kind of material. So it is an introduction of how they got the idea. I don't know, there's no information on it. There's been presentations as to what they look like. People have studied them. And it's something that they seem to kind of skip around is that there's a confusion, like I said, about the Algonquin pipe bag and the Alaska bag. So what we're studying here is the Kunkuk bag, and it's one that was probably introduced after the fabric was brought here. And the Kunkuk women were really lucky because the binding that they put around the edge was silk, so beautiful. So they could do it by hand, and their stitching was very, very beautiful. So when you see the bags and their designs on there, and you look a little closer at the binding that was put on, you see them in the museums, it's actually silk binding, which makes it very light. So it makes a big difference when you use cotton binding. Now it makes it a little more bulky, but there isn't any that I can tell that we can use that will have the stretch to go around the corners like that. So the when you cut out the front and you get it ready, do the beadwork right away on there. That's going to take a lot of time. And there was a lady that presented a study that she did on these bags at the last session, that sharing our knowledge. And she found one very old bag that was from Alaska, and it was red. And there was absolutely no design. The beadwork was all around the edge, and it had a dark circle here and a dark circle with white around it here. And when you looked at it, you realize it's an actual copy of an octopus, the two eyes. So that's what you're going to have to keep in mind when you make these bags. The women intended for it to be a real octopus. So when you put your design, if you're going to do flowers, do one here and one here, and then in the middle, a larger flower to imitate the beak of the animal. The appendages where you can do a row of daisies, small flowers, and that's the suckers on the limbs of the octopus. So you can really have a lot of fun. And that's what the women did. They did those basic things first, and then they added limb branches and leaves and other flowers to put more designs on there. But that's what you do first and work on it. Because if you want it to become an atu, don't get crazy and put flags and all kinds of other things on there. Try to stick to the traditional idea so that it is recognizable as a real Tlingit bag that's used for dance and ceremony. Start looking at the pictures in the old books that shows the men and the women. And this is an item that's for men and women. We didn't have any dance regalia that was either for men or for women. So this was used to show prestige. And it's so beautiful, especially when there's two bags. There's a real nice picture of a Yakutat man that had two bags, and it's so beautiful on him, wearing a vest. So then you prepare the back of the bag, and so you're going to have to get binding to go from this corner across the top. You can sew it with a sewing machine and end it right there. Don't go any further. And I don't have if I can borrow somebody's pattern, the half one. I think it's the green. This is also made, you cut this from cotton, just like this. And don't back it, because you're going to begin to have a lot of bulk, and you don't want to do that. And you place this on the fold of the material, so that after you cut it, it looks like this. So then you will place this with the fold, open it up to the back will go on this, and you want the front of the material. So now you sewed the top, now you're going to do the appendages. This will be the back appendage. And you're going to start sewing the binding from here all the way around all these here until you get over here. So then you're going to have this part sticking up, because you have that for the other part of the appendage. So then you put together the whole thing with your design. And start at the top with your binding, and then put it together with this so that you have a pocket. And you're going to sew all the way around until you get down here, and you'll have this extra piece that's, and I have one that I will show you in a minute. So that you can have eight appendages, eight of these. If you sew these together, it's a finger bag. And finger bags, I think, are fairly a new idea. People that started making these couldn't figure out how to do the eight that the older women were so adept at making. So then it's not an octopus bag. So don't be confused about it. An octopus bag has eight of these. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. A finger bag, these are sewn together, and there's only four. So are there any questions or comments? Before I go on, anybody raising their hand? Nobody? Oh, I'm so good.
Yeah, go ahead.
So on the bag, should you have 1, 2, 3, 4 pieces? Eight fingers, the inside part, you sew two together.
This is a really important part of it.
You have to have two.
You have to have this too, in order to do the eight fingers.
It's the fold of the fabric, so that, that one piece of fabric gets touched on that fabric, and then it folds at the top. So that when they fold to that other one, it has
Yeah, if you had experience in making these banks, then please share with us what you have. Okay, I started this bag for my granddaughter, and fortunately I couldn't finish it. These are all iron-on appliques. So much for beadwork. Okay, and this is a very expensive way to go if you're, you want to do the iron-on. Make sure if you're going to do the iron-on, tack it down with beads, otherwise the flowers will start to come off after wearing it. But you can see the eyes and the beak. That's what it shows. And then you can play around. I did the smaller flowers here for the suckers that they have. And that's what you see in the photos. So the question that you have, I sewed the tape around the back here. And around the bottom of these. This is the back, all the way around. From here, not all the way around, but just from where the appendage starts, for the back. So you do all that, and then you finally put it together, and I decided to do it by hand, so I'm doing the beads, which decorates the whole thing. When you look at the bags, in the books, it does show that a lot of times there's decorative beads all the way around the whole thing. So now, for the vacuum, here's the back, and you have this cap that's kind of loose. And that's going to go to with the front. So you stitch the binding around there, all around this. Do not just leave the back loose. Leave the back part loose. Stitch all the way around. And that's how you get the eight appendages. Any questions? The part that separates the back and the front appendages are the hardest, but it's not that difficult when you start looking at these bags to figure it out. So you can, on the instructions, I put my phone number and my email and whatever you can write, call, panic. And then I bought these tassels, and they go on the bottom of these. The ladies made their own, but I'm really modernizing this one by using the appendage. The tassels on this. Mm-hmm. Instead of making a shoulder strap, I bought this cord, and you can buy it at Joanne's Fabric and attach it to your shoulder bag. It's probably not long enough, but it's long enough for my granddaughter. It's going to be using that. So if you have any comments or questions, and if you want to, you can come up and look at this bag and see if we can talk about how to finish off the bag. And the beadwork, just keep in mind that you're imitating an actual animal with our bag, our Kendall bag from Alaska. And please share the pattern with others. They want to copy the pattern. One thing I need to say about in your pattern, when I made them, I just cut straight up, and these are really close together like that. You're going to have a hard time sewing it. So take a scissor and trim it a little bit so that you have time, you have the space to put the binding on there. Okay, are there any comments or questions?
I have one question for you. I'm just wondering if there's a difference in patterns or design work between a men's and a woman's octopus bag.
They're all the same. They're all the same. Yeah. One of the things you read when you read about the beadwork on there, on this is in a lot of times we'll say Athabascan floral design. And I always grit my teeth when I see that. Although I apologize to Athabascans who do beautiful, beautiful work. The style of beadwork that the Kuntin women did was as beautiful but different. And we did flowers. We did birds. We did flowers. But it kind of became obvious to the women making the moccasins and making the beadwork that the totem designs were preferable. So they switched over and started making more totem designs, where they used to do geometric designs. It's amazing when you look at that and realize, is that geometric design that really scientific-minded Indian women. And they did floral and they did birds. And I have a whole album full of patterns that my mother had. When she passed away, I got it. And I separated them all, and there was lots of flowers. So it's not Athabascan style beading, because their style is very different than ours. It's in get style. So, are there any other questions or comments? The stores offer polyester felt, and most of the time you have to ask. Find out if they have any part wool felt, or you can order it. Sitka, I was surprised when I went there. In their dime store, they actually have wool felt. So it was really neat. I really bought up what I needed for making blankets and stuff at home. But most of the stores don't offer it, but you can ask. They do have like 35% wool, and that's a lot better than the polyester. And what do I have against the polyester? It's lightweight, and it also becomes fuzzy. So after you use it for a while, you're going to have to press it again, because it does get fuzzy. any other questions or comments? Tish has sort of moved me around a lot, but I think I found it.
Thank you.